If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice, tell the same old lies, if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life, there's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, a savior, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker.
It's that time of year again. We're going to talk for a few minutes this morning about deacon selection. Let's give it up for our deacons. I got to say, this church is blessed by some amazing deacons. Now, we will be collecting our deacon selection ballots, and this is for the members of the church. If you are a member of the church, we really want you and need you to fill out your deacon nomination form. Those deacon forms are located on the blue check-in table as well. Make sure that you get that. We're collecting those this Sunday, and we're collecting those next Sunday. God gave the church deacons because the church was growing, and it needed people to take care of the practical ministry of the church so that the elders and apostles could be freed up to focus on prayer and preaching. So we need you to nominate. We have several amazing deacons. We have several rotating off this year, and I believe we're going to have several new ones coming on because God is always raising up new leadership. So every member of this church, make sure over the next 2 weeks, this Sunday and next Sunday — next Sunday is the last Sunday — fill out your deacon nomination form. Just put it in the offering basket as that's going by. Fill it out, fold it up, put it in the basket. We'll collect them, we'll tally them, and then we will put the names of who the Lord led the church to nominate in the bulletin in the first two Sundays in July. So what do you look for? I want to nominate a deacon. What do I look for? The Bible tells us in 1 Timothy chapter 3, verses 8 through 13, it says, "Deacons likewise should be worthy of respect, not hypocritical, not drinking a lot of wine, not greedy for money, holding the mystery of the faith with a clear conscience. And they must also be tested first. If they prove blameless, then they can serve as deacons. Wives, too, must be worthy of respect, not slanderers, self-controlled, faithful in everything. Deacons must be husbands of one wife, managing their children and their own households completely, competently. For those who have served well as deacons acquire a good standing for themselves and great boldness in the faith that is in Christ Jesus." This church has always been blessed to have faithful men and women serving as deacons, as husbands and wives, serving as a team, and we love that. We need you to ask God, who are you leading me to nominate as a deacon? And make sure that you put that down. And if you're going to nominate somebody, when the Lord puts somebody on your heart, make sure that you know, as far as you know, they line up with that list of qualifications from the Word. Make sure that they're worthy of respect. Make sure that they are a mature believer. Make sure that things in their household are at a position, in a stable position, so that they can serve the church. And make sure that you go to them and talk to them first, because this office of a deacon is one that is supposed to be entered into willingly and voluntarily. Nobody gets voluntold to be a deacon except by the Lord above. We are asking, hey, would you — I've seen these qualities in your life — would you be willing to serve the church as a deacon? We've got some young men I think would be great. We've got some old men I think would be great. We've got every age in between. Praise God. Let's continue to seek God and ask Him, who's He selecting to be the servants of the church? All right, we got some other great stuff coming up. Check out this quick video.
Welcome to Antioch. Let's take a look at what's going on. PBS is kicking off June 28th. We still need you as a volunteer. Please see Jess Partouche if you can help. Also, we've got to set up that tent. Please see Tommy Aldridge. Setup date is Saturday, June 26th, starting at 8 a.m. The Scottsville 4th of July Parade is scheduled for Saturday, July 3rd. Please contact Aaron Lamonte if you would like to help with the float and or outreach for this event. The quarterly business meeting is scheduled for Wednesday, July 14th. We'll see you there. And that's all. Don't forget to turn in those deacon nominations. And happy Father's Day from Antioch.
All right, if y'all want to hop on your feet, we'll get to worshiping this morning.
These bones will sing, greater. Give the Lord praise this morning. Jesus, we're so thankful to be in this moment with you, Lord. Lord, you deserve all of our praise and more. Lord, you deserve more than all the praise we could give all the days of our lives. Lord, you're so worthy. You're so good. We love you so much, Lord. We're so thankful for what you've done for us, Lord. We're so thankful that you love us enough to send your son, Lord. The ultimate sacrifice of love, Lord, you came to us. You love us so much. And we're so thankful for that, Lord. You're such a good, good father. All the days of our lives, Lord, you're so faithful. You're so good, Lord. And we're so thankful for who you are, Lord. We love you.
Sometimes on this journey, I get lost in my mistakes. What looks to me like weakness is a canvas for your strength. My story isn't over, and my story's just begun. And failure won't define me, if that's what my father does. And failure won't define me, if that's what my father does. Lay your burdens down. Ooh, here in the Father's house. Check your shame at the door, 'cause it ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's find hope. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room. Prison doors fling wide, the dead come to life. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room. Miracles take place, the cynical find faith. Love is breaking through when the Father's in the room. Jericho walls are quaking, strongholds now are shaking. Love is breaking through when the Father's in the room. Say, love is breaking through when the Father's in the room. Ooh, lay your burden. Down. Ooh, here in the fire. check your shame at the door, 'cause it ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house. Ooh, lay your burdens down. Ooh, here in the Father's house, check your shame at the door, 'cause it ain't welcome anymore. You're in the Father's house.
Hallelujah. Give the Lord praise. We're in the Father's house. Amen. Amen. Jesus taught us to pray, you can be seated. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your Father loves you with an everlasting love, an unconditional love, and an unchanging love. And today, above all else on Father's Day, we want to honor and give praise and glory to our Heavenly Father. Amen. Doesn't matter what kind of family you came from. Doesn't matter what your background is, what your relationship with your earthly father is, or your lack of relationship with your earthly father. When you come into this place, you are in your Heavenly Father's house, and He loves you. Amen. First and foremost, let's say that. I want to say you have a loving Heavenly Father watching over you with His love and His grace. And we all know that the Lord disciplines us just like a father disciplines the child he loves. Amen. Sometimes it's not always pleasant, but He does. 1 John chapter 3, verse 1. We're going to be all over Scripture today. The Lord put this message on my heart. After God's heart. Being after God's heart. And I love this verse in 1 John chapter 3, verse 1. Look how great a love the Father has given us, that we should be called God's children. And we are. The reason the world doesn't know us is that it didn't know Him. I love that verse so much. We are children of God. If you have been saved, if you have received Jesus Christ, you are a child of the Most High, Almighty God. And we honor that today, and we think about that on Father's Day. And I want to say I love my earthly father, Greg Vogt. He's the man. And he raised me and loved me and trained me. And praise God, when I needed it, he spanked me. Woo! I mean, he loved me enough, and I needed that a lot. And he loved me enough to model what it means to be a man that loves God. And I think that we need to strive this morning, especially to the fathers in the room, to the men in the room, to the current fathers, to the future fathers, and to the spiritual fathers. We need to strive to be men after God's heart. And to all the women in the room, you need to strive to be women after God's heart, meaning you want to be like Him. You want to be close to Him. You want to model that relationship and model His character to the world. And I love Father's Day, and I don't care what the government says, I will never call it non-birthing person day, because that's ridiculous and it's idiotic and it's an attack against Almighty God. In the beginning, God made them male and female. That's how He made mankind, to capture His unique character and His divine glory, and to split us out, male and female, so that we each bear different loving characteristics. And so we say happy Father's Day. And Father's Day is great, although you may know this, it's not nearly as popular as Mother's Day. And I don't know why, I just know that it isn't. I know that there's a whole lot more money spent on Mother's Day. I know that the gifts given on Mother's Day are a whole lot better and more uniquer, if that's a word, than the gifts given on Father's Day. But I still love Father's Day because we get to eat. Amen. That's my favorite day. They come to me and they say, Daddy, what do you want to eat? And I say, man, let's have it all. Let's have steak and shrimp and chicken and just spread it out. And I love that. And I love, we get to give lame jokes, lame jokes and lame gifts to our dad. Micah came up to me the other day and he said, Dad, I have the perfect dad joke for you. And I said, what makes the dad joke? He says, well, it's corny and it's stupid, but you'll love it. I said, okay, thanks, son. And he said, so Dad, why can't we play board games in the jungle? I said, I don't know. It's, you know, from being fear of, you know, being torn apart. And he said, no, Dad, you can't play board games in the jungle because there's too many cheetahs. And he busts out laughing. And he said, Dad, I knew you'd love that joke. And I do. I heard one father say that he loved Father's Day because it's the one time in the year where he gets complete obedience from his family, because he tells them not to spend a lot of money on them, and they don't. They just get him a tie or something else. I remember one mother, in response to a gift she was given on Father's Day, sent a message to her husband, because this husband, for Mother's Day, gave his wife an iron, and his wife didn't appreciate it, and she showed him that she didn't appreciate it, because on Father's Day, she gave him an ironing board. She sent him the message, "You can do this yourself." Right? Now, all jokes aside, we really do need fathers. Fathers are so influential in the lives of their children. If you go to fatherhood.org or you go online and look at the statistics, usually I give you all these crazy statistics, and I don't want to do that this morning, but I do want you to know that fathers are so influential. My father, Greg Vogt, is the chaplain at Central Virginia Regional Jail, and on Mother's Day, he gave out, listen to this, over 400 cards for Mother's Day so that inmates could write their mother and send her their mothers a greeting card. Guess how many cards he gave out for Father's Day? This is a jail with a population of over 400 inmates. For Father's Day, he gave out three. There is a serious epidemic in this country, and it's an epidemic of fatherlessness. We need heroes, men. We need models. We need examples. We need men who are going to show the heart of God and go after the heart of God. And we need women who will say, yes, we're not afraid to be women, and we want to see men be godly men. Amen? Especially now, more than ever, when there is an attack on gender. You need to understand the attack on gender is really an attack on Almighty God. It's an attack on his character. It's an attack on his model, his plan. He wanted every person on the world to be in a protected, safe place where they experienced his love. How does he do that? He gave them a father and a mother. That's the blueprint. And you can't throw it out. You can't get rid of it. Dr. David Popenoe, who is a famous professor of sociology at Rutgers University, he said this: fathers are more than just second adults in the home. Involved fathers, especially biological fathers, bring positive benefits to their children that no other person in their life is likely to bring. They provide protection and economic support and a male role model. They have a parenting style that is significantly different from that of a mother. And I like how he put that. We parent differently than mothers. Amen? I thought I was just beating my kids up and wrestling, but it's a parenting style. Simulating steel cage matches in the living room, son, that's a parenting style. You'll thank me later, okay? They are vitally important in a healthy child's development. Children learn compassion and empathy first from their father, not their mother. I'm just like, wow. And we see this vacuum in our culture. We see this vacuum in our world where there is an all-out assault on biblical masculinity. There's an attack on gender. We have to know it's an attack on God's image. And I believe it's time to show the world what it means to be real men and real women. It's time for the church to get out of the debates, to get out of just the discussion boards, and let's model what it means. The best way to attack this culture's war on pronouns is to walk in the power of Almighty God and live for Him before the world. That's what I believe. And I believe that we need to be men and women after God's own heart. And we see that after God's own heart is described a man named David. He was the king of Israel, and he was the greatest king up to date, because King Jesus will be the greatest king Israel ever has. Amen. But up until Jesus comes back, King David was the greatest king, and King David was given the kingdom. The kingdom was taken from a man named Saul, because Saul was a people pleaser and David was a God pleaser. And so in 1 Samuel chapter 13, God tells Saul that he's taking the kingdom away from him and he's going to give it to a man after his own heart. The testimony of David is repeated by the Apostle Paul in Acts chapter 13, verse 22, where it says that God testified about David, "I have found David, son of Jesse, a man after my own heart. He will do everything I want him to do." Now, if you have read the story of King David, is anybody familiar with this story? If you know the story of King David, hearing that he is a man after God's own heart is really encouraging, but it's also really, really confusing if you know the kind of life that King David lived. He was not a perfect man. He was a very conflicted, tormented, troubled man. I mean, he wrote over 73 Psalms, but you read through those Psalms where he talks about crying before God all night long, and he went on the run for his life. He had King Saul that wanted to kill him, and he had his own family kind of turn against him. And we think of King David, and we know that he was a worshiper, and that's awesome. We think of King David, and we know that he was a warrior, and that's great. But when you look at his track record as a husband and a father, he really failed miserably. King David was a man who was not just a worshiper, he was also a womanizer. He had such turmoil in his family. One of his daughters was raped by one of his sons in his own household. He had one of his sons lead a national rebellion against him and try to take him off of the throne. His son's name was Absalom, and he tried to destroy his father's kingdom. King David was a man who had a man killed just to cover up an illicit affair that he had with her. And we read about this guy and we think, this is a man after God's own heart? I mean, because of King David's pride in numbering his army and numbering his people against God's will, there were 70,000 Israelites who died because of his pride. So how in the world can he be called a man after God's own heart? I'm here to tell you this morning, if King David can be considered a man after God's own heart, it's good news for you and me, because if you've messed up as a father, if you've messed up as a husband, and if you've messed up as a leader, there's hope for you today. Amen. We can be, and we're called to be, people after God's own heart. How do we do it? I think we need to be powered by prayer and praise. We need to treasure the Word of God, and we need to model God's love. How can we be people after God's own heart, powered by prayer and praise, treasure the Word of God, and model God's love? And that's point number one, is be powered by prayer and praise. I love that King David was a prayer and praise warrior. He loved to worship. He would be out in the field worshiping as he watched over the sheep, as he's killing lions and bears as they come after his flock. He's writing psalms. He's worshiping, tons of prayer and praise in his life. And you cannot say it enough. If you want to be a person after God's own heart, you got to be powered by prayer and praise. There's no other way to get there. There's no other way to achieve that. That's how you enter into that relationship with your Heavenly Father. It's through prayer and it's through praise. It's by telling God how great He is and praying to Him and talking to Him and communicating with Him. One of my favorite things as a father is when my son will just come up to me or my daughters will just come up to me and they'll say, Dad, can we just go for a ride? I just want to talk to you. And we're talking, and I've learned as they talk, I just need to listen and affirm and identify their feelings and take time and not just jump on them when they say something and say, well, that's dumb. Why in the world would you think that? No, instead of don't do that, and just listen and say, man, that's interesting. How does that make you feel? What are you going to do about it? What do you think God wants you to do? And having this kind of conversation, that's what builds a relationship. Do you realize that when you're praying, that's what you're doing with your Heavenly Father? He just wants you to talk to Him. He just wants you to praise Him. He just wants you to celebrate with Him. That is where God moves when His people pray and praise. The Bible says that He is enthroned upon the praises of His people. You need to understand, when we pray and praise, you are opening the doors of heaven for divine intervention in your life. You want God to do something in your life? You know how it happens? Prayer and praise. And it's really hard to separate the two. When you read throughout David's prayers, and I encourage you to read through the Psalms, in every one of his prayers, he's praising. Every single time he prays. Many times when Jesus was praying, he was also praising. It's impossible to talk to God without thanking Him for all He's done. Amen? Because He's a good, good Heavenly Father. He's done so much for us. We need to pray and praise. Now, my mother-in-law, Linda, read this scripture on Mother's Day when she preached on being gap girls. It's Ezekiel chapter 22, verse 30. Ezekiel 22, 30 says this. God speaking. He says, I looked for a man among them who would repair the wall and stand in the gap before me on behalf of the land so that I might not destroy it, but I found none. My mother-in-law said, we need some gap girls in this church. Amen. I believe we do. I also think, you know what? We need some gap guys in this church. God is looking for some people. Our culture is broken. Our society, the foundations are crumbling and breaking. What God needs is not another commentator. What God needs is an intercessor, somebody that says, I'm going to stand in these broken walls and I'm going to call on Almighty God until something changes. And recognizing the fact that when you stand in the gap, the first thing that changes is you. God's looking for prayer warriors and praise warriors. 1 Timothy 2:8, Paul says this, Therefore, I want the men in every place to pray, lifting up holy hands without anger or argument. He says, I want the men in every place, and he's talking about in every church, to go out publicly into the public places and pray, lifting up holy hands without arguing. Now, I love that because whenever you get a group of guys together, there's many times there tends to be some arguing. There many times tends to be some anger involved. And Paul is like, no, you know what? We need to be different than the world. When we get together as men, we don't need to fight and argue and be angry and stir up dissension. No, when we get together, I want you guys to pray in unity and lift up holy hands to God. How different would the world look? How different would Fluvanna County look? How different would America look if the men of God would get together and pray publicly? Think about it. Do it at your job. Do it when you go to the grocery store. Do it wherever you're at. Do it at the office. Do it at home. Do it everywhere. Pray, lifting up holy hands without anger or argument. Man, when we get together, guys, we like to get angry, don't we? We get angry about the cultural problems, don't we? Well, those daggone blankety blanks, right? And I'm not cussing. I mean like liberals or Republicans. That's the kind of stuff we say. But those aren't curse words. I just didn't say them. Oh, it's those people. I can't believe this culture. I can't believe they're making us villains. They're doing this. They're doing that. And we get angry. We start arguing and discussing and solving all the world's problems. And then, oh, well, hey, good talking to you. Got to get going. We didn't do anything productive. What would happen if when we got together, say, hey, man, it's great to see you. Why don't we take a minute right now and let's pray together that God will do something in your life and in my life today that makes an impact for him in the world. That's got to be our first priority. It should be the first priority of every activity, of every meeting. Let's pray to God. And we need to model this in our homes and set the example for this in our homes, men and women. We need to let the praises of God be heard in our home more than our streaming services, more than our ringing phones. And our social media posts need to be less about the problems and more about prayer and the power of God. Amen? We need to model that. We need to do that. That's what changes the world, in a world that is trying to erase God. That is what is happening in your America right now. Your culture, your society, your government wants to erase God. In that culture, we need to carry his presence. Amen? One of the most enjoyable things we have done since Ezra has come into our family is we're teaching him how to pray. And so we have family meals and we sit down and we all fold our hands. And the first time we did it, he's like, what are we doing? Just looking around like, he's like, okay. And he's like one eye open looking at all of us. And we pray. And at the end, we all say in Jesus' name, amen. Well, he's really started to enjoy that. And this past week, we were running around hectically like we always are, trying to get to the ball field, trying to get here, trying to get there. And we're rushing dinner. We're trying to say, because we said, look, we're going to have family meals together and really teach them what it means to be a family. But then life happens, and so we're like having family meals together. We're all eating our plates as we're going out the door. And it's so funny because everybody gets stirred up, and everybody has it, and I'm starting to eat, and Ezra goes, Papa, stop! Four words he knows really, really well. Mom says that 1,000 times a day. Papa says that, you know, a couple hundred times a day. Stop! And the one word he learned fastest was no. Isn't that amazing? I mean, he learned that one real quick. Come here. No. Eat that. No. Go to bed. No. No, no, no. He learned that. But he looks at me. He says, Papa, stop. He didn't even know the word yet. And we all did. We all took a minute. We all stopped. And we all prayed together. And then we all said together, in Jesus' name, amen. If we're too busy to pray, we're too busy. Bottom line. This has got to stop just being something that we know we're supposed to do. And it's got to be something that we do. I love Martin Luther. I never forget this. I say it, and I'm going to keep saying it. When Martin Luther was asked about his day, he said, I have so much to do today, I need to spend at least 3 hours in prayer to get it all done. Let that put it in perspective. What if you looked at your activity book, your day planner, or your events on your phone? I got this great new, the church has a great new administrative assistant. Her name is Amanda, and she built a calendar for me, and now every hour I have my phone is going off with this reminder. You have to do this, you have to do that, you have to do that. And it's great because I was so disorganized before, and now I'm being told everything I'm supposed to do And so it's like a virtual wife. It's great, telling me, do this, do this, do this, do this. And so, but I start thinking about this as I'm preparing and as I'm talking, I'm going to preach on prayer. What if for every single activity in my calendar, what if I spent 15 to 20 minutes in prayer just for that event? How different would my life be? How different would my week be? I don't know yet, but I know that this is something that I'm going to try to do, and I encourage you to do it. Everything you have to do today. I got to go here. I got to take the kids here. I got to pick this up. I got to make dinner. I got to take this to this person. I got to go to this meeting. What if every single event, you began to surround it with prayer and praise to God for what he's going to do? Maybe it will make a difference. I know it will, and I know that if you're going to be the person after God's heart, you got to do it. Point number two. Treasure God's word. David said this, Psalm 119, 10 through 11. I have sought you with all my heart. Don't let me wander from your commands. I have treasured your word in my heart so that I might not sin against you. Now, I got to pick on the men for just a little bit because you know we got treasures, if you didn't know that. And when I think of man's treasure, there's only one thing that pops into my mind. And it's my gun safe. Anybody else? Anybody, if you got a nice, big, manly gun safe, just lift up your hand. I mean, come on. It's okay to wave, but we're not afraid. We're not God and guns, right? Yeah. And so I think about that, and I think about it like if everything else in my house burns down, the only thing that will withstand the BTUs in the heat are my guns. I may lose everything, but there will be a gun safe standing tall with all my weaponry. Why? Because it's something that I treasure. Do you treasure the Word of God like that? Is the Word of God so precious to you that no matter what comes at you from the outside world, no matter how hot it gets in your life, no matter how great the pressure, nothing can shake and penetrate what God's Word has done in your heart and in your life? Do you treasure the Word of God? That's what we need to do. What would happen if we treated God's word like that, kept it in such a secure place in our lives so that nothing from the outside world could corrupt it or change it? We need God's word to be our main treasure. King David said this in Psalm 19, verses 10 and 11. He said that your words are more desirable than gold, more desirable than the abundance of pure gold, sweeter than honey which comes from the honeycomb. In addition, your servant is warned by them, and there is a great reward in keeping them. I want you to hear me today, men and women of God. The more you treasure God's word, the more power there will be in your words. The more you treasure God's word, the more power there will be in your word. I'll never forget when I was in Bible college, I had a Bible my first 3 years. I loved it. I was always in it, and it was tattered and falling apart. Pages were falling out of it, and we were invited, our discipleship school was invited to staff devotions, and it was a mega church of 5,000 members, and it was a staff of 20 pastors, and we're invited to come and sit in on the morning staff devotions. Now, I'll never forget because I get called on, and they say, hey, David, would you like to read the scripture this morning for staff devotions? And I'm like, sure. I would love to. And my Bible is so tattered. I mean, it is falling apart. Pages, like the New Testament is just falling out onto the ground. I'm like, oh, I'm so sorry, I'm so sorry, I'm so sorry. And one of the staff pastors reached over and he gave it to me. And I said, I'm so sorry, my Bible's a mess. He said, son, as long as your Bible is a mess from being used, chances are your life won't be. The more you treasure the Word of God, listen to me. The more you treasure the Word of God, the more power will be in your words and the better direction you'll have for your entire life. We need to hide and treasure his word. We hear that hide his word in our heart, but don't miss the true meaning. Treasure his word. Really savor it, protect it, and value it, and have it as the crown jewel of our hearts and our lives. It has to be the word of God. And you'll never obey the commandments of God if you don't read and know and study the commandments of God. Men and women of faith, if we want to be after God's heart, we have got to be prayer warriors and praise warriors, and we have to treasure God's word. And lastly, point number three, we got to model God's love. We got to model God's love. We got to say it, and we got to show it. Everybody say it, show it. The words that you speak have so much power. I want you to understand the Bible says that the power of life and death are in the tongue, and that those who love it will eat the fruit of it. You need to understand that the primary purpose of words is not to communicate. Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth was formless and without shape, and darkness hovered over the surface of the deep. The Spirit of the God hovered over the surface of the deep. And then what it says right after that is, God said, let there be light. See, God doesn't use his words to do anything but create until verse 26, when it says, God said, let us make man in our own image. And still creating there, but communicating is a secondary function of your words. Creation is the first. So whenever you are speaking, before you say anything to your wife, to your kids, to your boss, to whoever you're talking to, ask yourself this question: what will these words create? Because there's a lot of us in this room today that we're struggling with our identity, we're struggling with where we're at in life, we're struggling with how we're supposed to move forward because of words that somebody spoke against us. Maybe it was your father or another influential figure where they told you that you're too dumb, you're not good enough, you can't do it, and you'll never make it. And those words created shame and guilt and doubt in your life. This morning, you're in your father's house, and he says that he loves you with an everlasting love, and he says that he formed you before you were formed in your mother's womb. He knew you and had plans for you, and he's going to empower you and fill you with his Spirit so that you can change the world. We got to speak life. You want to see a different atmosphere in your house? Change what you say. Come on, dads.
Well, no one ever listens to me around here. Everybody gets everything that they want. Everybody walks around here with all their toys, all their goodies, but nobody listens to me.
I'm picking on me, not you. I know you would never say that. It's just me. What would happen if we started speaking words that would create courage? Man, son, I'm so proud of you. You know that God made you with a plan on your life. Hell is scared of you. You know that, son. When you walk into the hallways of your school this coming year, you know that Satan's scared of you being there because he knows as long as you're there, the gospel is there. Honey, I love you so much. Piper, you are so beautiful. You were created in the image of God. You just carry around this confidence, this sweetness. And whenever you smile at somebody, you know, it brightens everybody's day. God created you for that purpose, honey. Don't change who you are. Don't let anybody tell you how you're supposed to be. Let God tell you how you're supposed to be. What would change in your house? You want to change the atmosphere? Start with the words you say. But it's not just enough to say it, is it, guys and gals? It's amazing to me that Jesus on the earth, fully God, fully man, the Son of God, three times, did you know three times in his earthly ministry, he still heard the verbal approval of his heavenly Father? At his baptism, when he's beginning his ministry, the heavens open up and the disciples heard the voice of the Father saying, this is my beloved Son with whom I am well pleased. What did God the Father do to the Son before he began his ministry? He affirmed him. He approved him. He encouraged him. Maybe that would change. Well, why are you doing that? Well, who told you to do that? Well, that's so dumb. Why in the world would, come on, who, come on, you know better than that. You can do better than that. What if you switched it around to say, that's it, that's, you're almost there, keep trying. You can do it, I know you can do it. Let's try again, you'll get there, don't worry. What if you changed? What if you started sounding more like your heavenly Father instead of the devil when you talk to your family? Yikes. Because we have an accuser. We have somebody who's always throwing our past up in our face. You know who that is? That's Satan. We as men and women of God are called to speak the way the Father speaks. Amen? We're called to create. We're called to create. Now, we got to show it. We got to model it. My family spells love T-I-M-E. It's showing it with our time. Being intentional. Every activity isn't a chore. It isn't drudgery. It isn't, oh God, I got to do this again. I got to spend time with you until you go to sleep, and then I can get to doing what I really want to do. No, come on, Dad. Let's be intentional. I love this verse from Proverbs chapter 23, verse 26. Listen to this. Proverbs 23, 26. This is the father speaking to his son. He says, my son, give me your heart. Give me your heart. And let your eyes watch my ways. What's this fight? Amen, brother. Ezra's amening me already. What's God saying? He said, son, above all else, daughter, above all else, you know what I want more than anything else in the world? I want your heart. I want your heart. I want your attention. I want your affection. I want you to watch me. And listen, when you don't know what to do in this world, you don't have to look anywhere else. You can look to me. And I'll show you how to love God. I'll show you how to serve God. I'll show you how to be a man in this culture when everyone's trying to get rid of men. Because come on, somebody, man, we ain't going anywhere. Come on. Oh, can I get an amen from the men of God? I ain't going to stop being no man. I love being a man. Because I know my responsibility is to model and demonstrate for my family how much their Heavenly Father loves them. That's heavy. That's huge. The only way we can do that is if we learn to become prayer and praise warriors. There's going to be so many times, almost all of my prayers, Lord, I cannot do this without you. I need you to give me the strength. I need you to give me the patience. I need you to show me. And praising you, Lord, thank you that this is going to end in victory. I have to treasure the word of God. This has to be my blueprint for life. The truth of God's word has to be the foundation of our souls. It's got to be the anchor for our souls. This has to be alive in us. It can't just be dusty on a shelf. It had better be alive in your everyday life. And we got to model God's love. I want to challenge all the men and women of faith in this room. Let's fight for the hearts of our families. Let's fight for the hearts of our community. And for those who don't have a family, who don't have a father, let's be a church that says, you know what? We will be your family and we'll introduce you to your Heavenly Father. Because we want to be people, men and women, after God's own heart. Not perfect, but modeling God's love. I want the worship team to come. Before you can model God's love, you have to first receive God's love. You know, I've always preached over the years, and I firmly still, I believe it with all my heart, and I've always said it, and I've told you this, men and women of God, our first priority, our number one identity, it's not our jobs, it's not our status. Our number one identity for me, it's to be a husband and a father. And I firmly believe that for years. You know what I discovered? Something that I was wrong. You know what my first primary identity is? It's not as a father. It's not as a husband. It's as a son. Our first identity is as children of God. Dave Vogt's first identity is as a son of God. Then, once you get that relationship right, and you're receiving the love of God, the affirmation, the strength, the power, then I can love my wife. Then I can be a husband, and I can model what it means to be a husband like Jesus that loves his wife the way Christ loved the church. Amen? Your first identity is that of a son and a daughter of God. And maybe you're here today, maybe you're watching today, and you need to start that relationship. You say, you know what, Pastor Dave, I have no relationship with God. I'm here to tell you, your Heavenly Father loved you so much. God demonstrated his love for you in that while you were still a sinner, he sent Christ to die for you, to pay the price for your sin, and to restore you into relationship. You got to start there. Maybe you're here this morning and you say, Pastor Dave, that's me. I need to accept the love of Almighty God. Maybe you're here, you need to start that relationship. Maybe you're here this morning and you need to jumpstart that relationship. Maybe your relationship with God was stalled. Maybe you're here and you say, Pastor Dave, I want to be a man or a woman after God's heart. I want to be a godly father. I want to be a man that leads my family. I want to be a woman that loves and serves my family and supports my husband. Well, whatever it is, but I need to get right. I need to jumpstart that relationship with God first so that then I'm in proper alignment and can be the husband, the father that I'm called to be. We're going to sing this song again about being in the Father's house. The good news is that you came to the right place. Amen. You can check your shame at the door because it ain't welcome here. You can leave your sin at the cross because Jesus paid for it. Amen. And you and I can say, in this time, in this day, we are going to be men and women that are after God's heart. Amen. Let's stand together and sing.
Lost in my mistakes, it looks to me like weakness is a canvas for your strength. My story isn't over, and my story's just begun. If failure won't define me, cause that's what my Father does. If failure won't define me, cause that's what my Father does. Lay your burdens down. Ooh, hear in the Father's eyes. Check your shame at the door. Sin ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's
after God with our whole hearts. Amen. You were given a gift, or you should have been given a gift as you came in, and we're giving gifts to fathers and mothers, to the guys and the gals today, because I was reminded by the office staff that they said, well, Pastor Dave, you can't give a gift to the dads because on Mother's Day the moms didn't get anything, and you can't give a gift to the dad without giving a gift to the mom. So we got gifts for everybody. Amen. Everybody getting a gift. But you got a devotional. You know where it starts? You start going after God's heart today by going to Sunday school, by going wherever you're going next, and by praising and praying, by treasuring His word, and by saying, I'm going to model His love. So we've got a devotional for the men and for the women. 1 minute devotionals. You can start 1 minute of every day and go from there until you're devoting more and more of your time to the heart of God. Amen. And we've got these little wristbands. You may not be a wristband person, but put this somewhere. If you're not going to wear it, put it somewhere in your house, in your job, in your car, that reminds you, what's my purpose in life? Why am I here? It's to go after God's heart. Amen? It's to go after God's heart. I'm going to praise and pray my way all the way through life. I'm going to treasure God's word and obey it, and I'm going to show people, I'm going to model the love of God to the world. Amen? Heavenly Father, I thank you for dads. I pray you will help every man, every father and future father, every spiritual father in this room to be defined by your word, to live like Jesus, to be tough and loving, to be just and caring and merciful and gracious, to speak the truth unapologetically in love, full of your power. And I pray for the moms. I pray, oh God, for the ladies that are supporting these men of God, and some of them who are leading their families on their own. Lord, you know every situation. I pray that everyone will leave here today knowing that their Heavenly Father knows them, loves them, and has prepared a plan for them in their life. Help us to follow it. Help us to run after your heart. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen and amen. God bless you. Happy Father's Day. We hope you'll stay with us for Sunday school. Have a great one. Hello, my name's Dave, and I'm the pastor here at Antioch Baptist Church. I just want to thank you for joining us for this time of praise and worship. I hope that it impacted your life and that it inspired you to take your relationship with God to the next level. If you were watching today and you felt convicted by the Lord to accept Christ as Savior and Lord of your life, I want you to pray this simple prayer with me. Just say, "Dear Jesus, I'm a sinner. I need you to make me new. I invite you into my life to be my Lord and to be my master. I believe that you rose from the dead, and I believe that you are the Son of God, and I believe that you will return to the earth again to take me home to be with you. Jesus, thank you for saving me. Thank you for dying for my sin. I receive you now as my Lord and Savior. Amen." If you prayed that prayer and if you responded to that message today, we'd love to hear about it. I want you to contact us here at the church and let us know about the impact that it's had on your life so that we can celebrate with you and so that we can give you some resources to help you in furthering your walk with Jesus. Thank you so much for tuning in. God bless you. And remember to love, connect, go, and grow.
If you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice, tell the same old lies, if you're trying to feel the same old